The World Wildlife Fund for Nature is the world's largest conservation organization, with a stated mission to create a world in which people and wildlife thrive together.
This is not about saving one panda, one forest, or one habitat. This is no act of charity. It's an act of survival.
But in 2019, accusations emerged that they had funded park rangers that were implicated in murder, torture, and rape. In the Salanga National Park in the Democratic Republic of Congo, indigenous peoples speak of suffering beatings, rape, and murder at the hands of guards.
WWF, DRC is extremely involved in the running of the park. It wasn't until a year later that one of the more senior people in WWF DRC asked, what's happening with this? He found out that the park director and the country director had blocked further investigation, and that they did so pretty clearly because they were concerned about adversely affecting their relationship with the government.
Other examples of WWF-linked human rights abuses have emerged in the Central African Republic, the Republic of Congo, and in Cameroon.
The guards, they can set fire on the camp to say the fire belongs to a poacher. But sometimes it is a camp of the Baka communities.
WWF staff members on the ground in Cameroon were aware of abuses by the eco-guards and didn't address those complaints. But WWF international staff continued to ignore the reports of instances of rape, of murder, of torture, particularly of indigenous communities.
The illegal wildlife industry is estimated to be worth up to $23 billion a year. It's the world's fourth largest illicit market, and it's run by violent organized crime groups ready to go to war with anyone who gets in their way.
He tried to shoot me, like this, he says.
In its efforts to stamp out poaching, the WWF has supported governments and co-sponsored forest rangers which provide cash, weapons, training, and high-tech enforcement equipment. But these anti-poaching units now stand accused of carrying out atrocities against indigenous communities. So how did this happen? How did an organization which aims to preserve animal life and biodiversity end up accused of supporting groups that rape and murder? This is the story of the WWF's system error. Founded in 1961, the World Wildlife Fund for Nature was created to support the work of existing conservation groups struggling to save endangered species. The WWF helped fund many programs around the world, and as early as 1963, published an important paper on the threat of global warming. The organization has since grown exponentially, expanding beyond preserving endangered species to promoting biological diversity and sustainability, reducing pollution, and slowing climate change. But in 2019, a BuzzFeed investigation would starkly challenge the image of the WWF, with accusations they had funded eco-guards that committed human rights abuses and murder.
What the allegations specifically revolved around was beatings, torture, and extrajudicial killings by eco-guards who had been trained and funded by WWF.
In all cases, they were essentially alleging that WWF was funding despite knowledge of the park rangers, at least allegedly, being involved in human rights abuses, including murder and torture.
John Knox was a member of the independent panel the WWF created to investigate these allegations. What they discovered was that the WWF had a systemic problem that it had chosen to ignore for years.
We didn't find evidence that WWF itself was directly involved in any murders, tortures, or rapes in the sense that WWF staff members were somehow carrying them out. The WWF, for years, has had very strong commitments on paper to make sure that they're safeguarding human rights. And the problem is they have not put the necessary implementation to do what they say that they'll do.
The organization has not publicly apologized to the victims or their families, while the independent report has cleared WWF staff from direct involvement in the allegations.
There's a kind of sleight of hand there. While they weren't directly directing those abuses, and WWF staff were not engaged in directly in abuses, they were part of a wider system that led to those abuses.
In other words, offices within WWF always tell each other only the good news. In the DRC, where they simply didn't report the fact that they were receiving serious human rights allegations. But when that report was presented to the international board, they actually made the situation sound better than it really was.
The failure of the WWF to act on serious allegations was repeated in Cameroon, where human rights abuses were also reported.
The failure was on the part of WWF as a whole, as an entire organization. It's the responsibility of WWF International and the WWF International Board of Directors to make sure that these kinds of abuses didn't happen.
The WWF is a federalized organization, meaning that each branch operates independently with supervision from the head office, and different countries have different ways of accepting funding. So although the WWF provides the cash, how that money is spent is often at the discretion of local governments.
WWF DRC co-manages the park, so they're able to provide funding more directly for park management, including park rangers. In other places like India and Nepal, the government is much more, let's say, exclusionary to WWF. So it really varies quite a bit from government to government.
And eco-guards do face very real threats on the ground. Nearly 50 were killed in 2018 alone. They undoubtedly need appropriate equipment and training to face off against the poachers.
These more militarized strategies have led to abuses of local communities and even PTSD amongst rangers, because they believed that they were going to be doing a job that was about wildlife management, and they had roles in kind of ecological monitoring and so on. But then as poaching escalated and as conservation became more militarized, they find themselves drawn into engaging in much more forceful forms of conservation that perhaps they didn't sign up for.
But in some instances, as in the Central African Republic, guards received paramilitary-style training in weapons handling and combat tactics. Without proper oversight, it is believed by many that this training was then turned on innocent people from indigenous communities. And in Cameroon, guards were incentivized to catch poachers, ivory, and weapons with bonuses, increasing the potential for human rights abuses. Charles Nsokali, an indigenous Baka from the DRC, has produced documentaries on the indiscriminate manner in which these park rangers operate.
There was a serious case, what we call the anti-poaching squad. Some go with violence and beat the Baka who are settled in the forest, just to tell them where the poachers are.
They're kind of induced to go after these really bottom level poachers, but they don't have the resources. And frankly, I think there's political opposition to them going up the line to get the higher ups, because often those people are quite wealthy and well connected, and the government doesn't really want to go after them.
Amidst these scandals, the WWF continues to receive funding from major corporations like Coca-Cola and IKEA, seeking to greenwash their image.
It's really hard to see how partnering with some of the world's biggest corporations is going to solve any of the environmental problems that we face, because those corporations are deeply involved in creating the environmental crisis in the first place. Conservation organisations are in a really highly competitive funding environment, and so of course they were going to turn to corporations to get finance to support their work.
The WWF's problems are not simply issues of poorly trained or corrupt park rangers. There are issues with the organization's entire strategy of advocating for the isolation of protected areas from any human impact.
Historically, the underlying idea of a lot of national parks, starting in the United States with Yosemite and Yellowstone, was that certain areas should be kept completely preserved for future generations. In Africa, the early national parks were colonial game preserves, where people, you know, from Germany or France or the UK wanted to go and be able to hunt. What these things often had in common is that they disregarded the people who already had lived there for many, many generations.
Locally known as fortress conservation, these areas are often run by militarized units that keep locals off the lands where they have lived for generations. Currently, 17% of land on the globe accounts for protected areas, including national parks.
The law in the DRC is that it's illegal to hunt or fish or live in Salonga, and there's pressure to basically move out the remaining villages. There's only a handful left in a, again, a park the size of Belgium. There's still pressure from this kind of fortress conservation idea to make the parks a kind of protected natural area that no humans are allowed to step foot in.
This model has since been replicated by countries around the world and recognized through programs such as UNESCO's World Heritage Sites. And now, organizations like the WWF are supporting the expansion of these natural areas through the UN's Convention on Biodiversity, which aims to expand the world's protected areas from 17% to 30% by 2030.
There are a great many of us who are really concerned that this easy banner headline of 30 by 30 will actually give new impetus for possibly the biggest land grab in history, which will result in the violent displacement and eviction of some of the world's poorest people.
Local people are rarely factored into the equation, increasing the potential for conflict and human rights abuses. As indigenous people are run out of their forests, beaten and abused for living their lives the way they have for generations, reports indicate that animals like elephants, gorillas, and chimpanzees are still in decline.
This does not work for conservation purposes. It's hard to emphasize that enough. There are dozens, hundreds of studies that show that without the support of indigenous peoples and local communities, excluding them simply results in bad conservation outcomes, as well as violating their human rights.
But when you don't work together with the baka and you don't leave them freely in the forest, conservationists will not have the objective to know exactly what is going on wrong in the forest.
WWF response is extremely disappointing. WWF did not apologize or even take responsibility for the failures to comply with its responsibility to respect human rights. They continued to point the finger at its government partners and at the difficult conditions in the countries in which it operates. But those can't be excuses.
While the WWF is a federalized organization and some groups continue to do important work, the WWF's push to stay relevant may be further harming its original mission of protecting endangered species, as well as leading to horrific human rights abuses and even murder.
I think WWF's will to survive is something that will definitely continue. It's a big organization. If they stop tomorrow, would be really negative for people and for biodiversity. It would be much better to be working much more collaboratively and constructively with people who live with wildlife and live in these areas and have done sustainably for generations, rather than trying to impose an externally derived model from experts who don't actually live in those environments.